same mission. Mississippi Public Broadcasting. Mississippi is our mission.
My family roots run deep in the wetlands of southeast Louisiana. Our Houma people have been living off these lands and waters for hundreds of years.
That's a nice one. Oh, listen to it.
They're talking. That's a fish that's talking.
I want to keep living on our land, but I'm inheriting a dying delta. My name is Monique Verdin. I was born during a springtime Louisiana flood. Spent my first years living in a single-wide trailer on my family's land. I loved running barefoot on the bayou side.
When it floods, there's a tiger fish.
After my parents divorced, my mother moved us 3.5 hours away to Pensacola Beach, Florida. I spent my childhood dreaming of returning to Louisiana. Thirteen years ago, after graduating high school, I found my way back home. I moved in with my grandmother, who cares for my mentally disabled uncle, Neg. I've always loved being with my grandmother, Mateen. I'm drawn to her ways, the old ways of the Houma Indians.
You just stab the pork, it's straight like a bean.
I had a feeling these ways might someday disappear, so I started documenting them.
Where to next? So you put the good feathers in that bag.
Mm-hmm. Okay, that's the name for tomorrow. That's five dogs.
Oh.
Yeah, and our man.
Okay. Henry, Joe, Jack, Jim, and Bob.
Mm-hmm.
Great.
My grandmother lives by the cycle of the moon, planting her garden when it's full and cutting her hair when it's new. She collects rainwater for drinking and bathing. She believes prayer has the power to heal. My grandmother told me stories of her childhood days, living with her clan in thatched palmetto camps. They were the indigenous people of the Delta, whose bloodlines were mixed with French settlers. They fished the waters and hunted and farmed on the land. The Louisiana Purchase had forced my ancestors into the least desirable swamplands between the Atchafalaya and Mississippi rivers. The Houma Nation has never been federally recognized. My grandmother just calls herself French Indian. As my grandmother was growing up in the 1920s, the oil and gas industry was growing too, and oil rigs were spreading all around her. On my grandmother's 90th birthday, we took a trip down Bayou Ponichan to where she grew up.
Là, il y avait une maison ici, là, une city là, et là, il y avait. C'est lui en bas, nous combien? C'était notre docteur, ça. C'était notre docteur indien. Quatre maisons.
We were surprised how wide open these bayous are. Once they were only wide enough for a pirou boat to pass.
Et qu'au fait ta partie ici?
Le monde, le bayou de la Fauche était après prendre toutes nos places ici.
Et piégé.
Tous les compagnies après ça, il a rentré.
Quelle compagnie?
Ah, moi, je connais pas.
Des compagnies de quoi?
D'huile.
Est-ce qu'il a payé pour le temps?
Well, they would come and make them sign paper saying that we were going to have something. And they would give you $10, $15, $20, $25 sometimes. And that was it. That was to take the profit that they were making them sign.
When my great-grandparents marked their X onto those papers, they didn't know how to read or write. They barely knew how to speak English. But that X took away their land and so much more.
Are we heading south right now?
From the time my grandmother was born in 1915 to the time I was born in 1980, the oil and gas industry laid tens of thousands of miles of pipelines and dug over 9,000 miles of canals. This web of pipelines and canals helps Louisiana produce or transport nearly one-third of the nation's oil and gas supply. Unable to trap their native lands, my grandmother and her family left Ponichan in 1943. They filled their tank with gas and moved to St. Bernard Parish, 20 miles from New Orleans. My father was raised in St. Bernard Parish. He grew up living the traditional ways and was proud of his native heritage. But when he started school in the thick of desegregation, he was beaten for his long hair and dark skin.
Well, I mean, it's gonna be fun. But I mean, if we can't go, I mean, if you both ain't gonna make it, don't worry about it. We'll go with the shop. We'll get a boat.
I wanted to be a daddy's girl, but my father wasn't always around. We got closer as I got older.
Pack a dog.
What is it?
a gray heron. They got blue, gray, and the white.
My father was always a magic man to me. He could make a car run without any gas, and he could make a dying man laugh. But he struggled with the drug and alcohol addiction. My father showed me the shortcut to New Orleans through the back of town of the lower Ninth Ward. There, he was known as Julio. He knew how to live on the edge, day to day, hand to mouth, beer to beer. One night on a New Orleans dance floor, I met a man named Mark Krasnoff.
How's the light?
I have night vision. Up close, it kind of blurs you out.
Is that automatic focus?
He introduced himself as a Cajun Choctaw Jew. It was like bumping into an old friend I had never met before. We walked the streets till sunrise, talking about our love for Louisiana.
What do you guys look out for?
Happy Mardi Gras!
I invited Kraz to come down the bayou to meet my family.
Hey!
This is Mark.
Mark.
Bernice.
Hello.
Hello. Hello. Comment la faire? Ça va?
Ça va?
He's a Cajun from his own flat.
My family felt comfortable with Kraz around. His curiosity was charming.
Dimanche de gras?
Hein?
Dimanche de gras?
Oh, oui, bien sûr.
Ouais.
Kraz started asking a lot of questions about my family's land.
How high does the water get when it comes here?
We gotta use a piro to go to the road.
You have to use a piro boat to get to the road?
To get to the road.
From your house?
Last year we had to do that. Just a little bit of storm that hit us.
Has it been getting worse, or has it always been like
that? No, it's getting worse. You see, the land is sinking. You see, more gas and oil you got underneath your ground, the higher you're going to stay. The more they're going to pump, the lower your land is going to go.
South Louisiana is losing almost an acre of land every hour. I started to see a bigger story in the photos I was taking of my family. As Kraz and I went deeper into exploring our Louisiana, we were also falling in love with each other. He taught me how to two-step in Zydeco dance halls, and we spent our Sundays parading in second lines. Within a few months, I was living with him at his home in uptown New Orleans. I was working at a coffee shop, and Kraz was working as an actor. He acted in a TV docudrama that showed an environmental crisis waiting to happen in Louisiana.
The fort's director of operations, John Hamill, knew he had little margin for error. A hurricane blew into the Gulf of Mexico that severed the supply of oil to the nation.
The loop pipeline that carries 1 million barrels of oil into America a day had been severed.
The show aired 3 months before Hurricane Katrina.
Today. We're in better spirits now that we know that her and Nag are alive and okay. Krasnov's oil storm is happening. It's 2005, September 3rd. It's my father's birthday. He's still missing.
Evacuated New Orleans on Saturday and ran to Baton Rouge. Baton Rouge was pretty bad, and as obviously we've come to be aware of, New Orleans is gone, actually.
How many days have they been missing?
It's today, Saturday, 6 days.
Section C, you see it? Section C. Hold up. Let me orient myself. This is C, right?
Well, I thought you talked to her and she said we were such and such place.
Yeah, she said exhibit hall C is what I'm walking into. Okay.
Yeah, but we can't even walk around. We're just going.
She said, they're by the men's restroom. Hey, 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 hey. Tu te sens? T'es correct? T'as mangé?
Oh ouais, bien mangé.
T'as dormi?
Pas de trop le soir, parce qu'on m'a perdu à lui. On a marqué marché de 4 heures jusqu'à... Comment est-ce que... Jusqu'à vers 6, 7 heures. Marché, marché, marché. Marché ici, marché là, j'ai perdu mon lit.
Ah, t'as pas dit ton lit.
You should start your own exercise show, Martine. The evacuee refugee exercise program.
Mama, you putting your hair in a bun or you want to braid it?
How are you feeling?
Better.
What does it mean?
Thank you.
They run a dog down the street.
My father survived the storm by camping out on our roof for 9 days with a flock of geese, a pig, a pack of dogs, and a bottle of tequila.
And Julio was on the porch, the little chihuahua was talking about. I said, stop it. Shut up. The geese ran all over to the porch. Everybody was on the porch. The pigs, the little pigs were on. I said, shut up.
My grandmother and uncle were pulled on a piro, slept on a shrimp boat for a couple of days, then walked the levee to safety. That piro helped save my grandmother when she was 90, just as a piro did when she was 11 in the hurricane of 1926. Our people have survived the natural cycle of floods and storms for centuries. But now, we face natural disasters in a world manipulated by man. The Mississippi River Gulf outlet, Mr. Go, was dredged in the 1960s as a shortcut from the Port of New Orleans to the Gulf of Mexico. During Katrina, the Mr. Go acted like a funnel for the storm surge, contributing to the failure of levees and allowing the surge to slam onto our land. Some of my relatives didn't want to talk about the uncertainty of our future.
I agree with you, Ruth, but the thing is that we know that it's Mother Nature, and we know that also it's a man-made disaster as well, because they went in and they cut the canal. You don't believe that the canals have caused erosion? I see it happening, and it's happened in a short amount of time. And I love Louisiana, and I want to live in Louisiana. They would have all been fine if that canal would have never been dredged. Yeah, they would have had some water, and yeah, they would have had some rain. What? No, you don't understand. This canal, the Mississippi... Okay, I was just trying to... Hello? She hung up on me.
Kraus found a place for us to stay near his hometown. We were together, but we still felt lost.
A shrimper has to make a living, and there's no living here now. Mr. Robin surveyed what's left of his life and his way of life. The family seafood business, gone. The ice house, gone. Mama's house, gone. This bridge, broke. Who's left to buy our shrimp and our oysters? Well, the oyster beds are gone. And where's our market? It's gone too. I got no choice. I think I gotta leave.
We weren't allowed to go back home for weeks, so Kraus snuck into New Orleans alone.
The situation down here is bad. It's big, okay? And it's not just New Orleans. It's the whole Gulf South. But New Orleans is really in rough condition. Yeah. So I just thought I would document this somehow. Just to kind of watch what's going on. Take note. The stress level's gonna get crazy.
Hurricane Rita hit before we could get our feet on the ground. After 6 weeks, we were finally able to see my grandmother's house.
Thank you.
I'm scared to touch anything.
What are you gonna miss most?
Looking out the kitchen window, talking to my grandmother while she washes her dishes. And going and getting water out of the cistern. And laying down to dream.
There's a what?
An armadillo. He's right there.
But he's alive.
Yeah. I guess he's a dinosaur.
Yes. Oh my God, he made it.
I step back to photograph and realize that this house was the least of our losses. The land was scarred and needed time to heal for us to make it home again. We found out an oil tank near our house had been pushed over by Katrina's flood, spilling 1.1 million gallons of crude oil. But this is just a fraction of the 8 million gallons of oil spilled during Katrina and Rita.
They're saying, sure, go in, go fix your house, go grab your kids, go dance, va, everything's parfait. There's just a foot of oil, but it's perfect, Matin. And whoever goes touch that poison, and it's all over, you're gonna get sick.
This isn't the first time my family has had to deal with the oil industry poisoning our land. My cousin Clarice has been fighting a legal battle since the 1990s to stop the dumping of oil field waste near her house.
Hi, my name is Clarice Freeloo. We learned that our children suffer from upper respiratory infections and bronchitis. We learned that our residents suffer from heart problems, and the list goes on.
I cannot sell my property. We have no value. You cannot get money to buy my house.
Why not?
Because they don't want to be liable, because it's not a resale. There's no resale on our property.
Because why is there no resale?
Is it considered condemned or something?
No, it's considered an all-field waste site.
And nobody wants to live there.
Even though it says non-hazardous, it still has hazardous characteristics.
I don't know. I just think that there's a story to be told as one full body, you know? Because it affects the whole thing. And if we can somehow piece it together here and there and tell it from the people's voice, not from an outsider's voice, you know? Because it is everybody's story. It's not just one person's interpretation of it.
Go ahead. Real slow.
Kraz and I took our cameras to the streets to capture the bizarre state of once familiar places.
Yeah, this is intense.
Bad idea. Trailer parks are a bad idea.
What makes you say that?
Houses being built in St. Bernard, period, is a bad idea.
For me, this documentation was a way to process our reality. for Kraz, it was a political statement.
The land is completely saturated and smothered with oil from their refinery just up the road. So all the water for the fishermen, the agriculture, all the livelihoods are poisoned by this stuff. It smells bad, and the swamp is black with oil. It's crazy. It's nuts.
Overdevelopment, unregulated oil and gas production, and misguided canals and levees all had roles in this disaster. And I was starting to find my role. We kept returning to our land down Bayou Road, even though our home was uninhabitable.
Good, I think. You're gonna have to have the house. Oh, but you need it.
Et c'est quoi ton ton idée?
J'ai pas d'idée à ce temps-là, j'ai une idée. Mon idée est égarée.
Et ton c'est quoi que tu espères?
J'espère voir si quelque chose va revenir, si ça va s'en faire. Je ne veux pas revenir autrement que quelqu'un d'autre revient. Je ne veux pas être ici. Et l'église, je ne sais pas. Et quand l'église va être arrangée, je ne veux pas être ici, pas d'église non plus.
And look, see these are all screens. See, so you can open it up and you can go in there now. So when you're here and you're working, you can go in and you'll be out of the mosquitoes.
Interesting, huh?
Ouais, c'est intéressant.
You're not impressed.
I think it's cool.
Yeah.
People were having a hard time getting back home, but the oil and gas companies seemed to have no trouble putting up new rigs.
I'm Mark Krasnov, bro.
Oh, yeah?
This is Monique. Her old grandmother lives down the road by the Toka plant.
Okay.
You mind if I film you?
I don't mind at all.
Tell me your name.
My name is Tommy Dunn.
And what is this?
Looks like an oil well to me. It just happened about the... It's my third week down here, and I come in, I saw this down here, and no one telling us what it is. No one telling what they're doing. I haven't seen no news, nothing like that yet, so I don't know what they're doing.
This is in your backyard?
Yeah, right, less than 100 feet.
Does it concern you?
We're very concerned.
One time they said that they would be doing something over here, and that if they would come on the land, on the curve, that they needed our permission, and they wanted us to sign the paper, and they would give us $25. And then after, you know, we said, well, on the curb, well, you know, I can't stop you from working on this curb. So I said, okay. And I took the paper, and I read over it after, and I told them, I said, wait a minute. This thing said it gives them permission to come all the way on the land for 2 years, and anything found on the land is theirs.
My grandmother says, if you don't know what to do, do what you know. Kraz was growing more and more anxious to see progress.
I'm very pleased to have with me Mark Krasnoff. He's an actor, an artist, an activist, a lifelong New Orleans resident. Welcome, Mark Krasnoff.
How are you, darling?
Just give us some sort of overall sense of the state of affairs.
The psychological effects of what's going on now, people are truly, truly, truly at their knees from every class, every race, every stature.
Kraz kept recording, even when no one was listening.
I'm not sure how Monique and I are pulling it off. Every day is basically like making up a new plan to try to get through it. You try to do something positive, and you know, you look around you, and all you see is devastation. I cry a lot. But I get up each day.
My father was also losing his sense of place. He seemed to be growing tired and weary. His liver was failing him.
So what happened, Dad?
I laid on my side.
Yep.
They gave me a little, I went down my throat. And I said, look, this is not gonna interfere with me wolfing down that baked potato, huh? She said, no. We're gonna have you well coated.
So then what?
I just laid there till they woke me up.
My father chose not to fight and accepted the consequences of his choices. The day he died, he took each of our hands and squeezed with all he had left. Then peacefully took his last three breaths. And that was it. With my father gone, I had lost another piece of my Louisiana. I retreated to my mom's on Pensacola Beach, Florida. Stayed busy working at the bar she managed.
Don't worry about anything. Hey.
When I returned to Louisiana, the debris from my grandmother's house had been cleared.
And what are you gonna do with the property now?
My grandmother and my uncle will be moving back here in October, hopefully, to live in a baby double wide modular home.
I started to see the timelessness of cycles, from ends to beginnings, I was trying to make peace with the way life was, but Kraz kept pushing to expose the injustice.
What's the relationship with you and your grandmother that you were just talking about? How's it disappearing? How's the land affecting it?
Well, in the 20th century...
Talk to me, man. Talk to me. What did you just say about Charlie and all them?
Not only are we losing our connection with the land, actually, with living on the land and fishing from the land and farming on the land, but also our land is polluted and it's washing away.
How are you losing your connection with the land? What do you mean by that?
I hate redoing this. I'm sorry,
Okay, let's not do a film then.
It's just, it's...
You said, if you're not gonna talk, are you ready to talk to the people? Are you truly?
Yeah, but it's, I mean, this is like awkward. This feels awkward.
What, talking? Like we were just doing? Talk to me.
Kraz and I were tired and frustrated. Our plans for the future kept shifting. He was such a good actor, I didn't realize how depressed he was.
I can feel myself sinking. I can feel myself sinking in my city. I can see there are no children running around, playing on the ground in my city. I can feel the trees are bare, there's no one there. I can feel that I am alone.
On September 16th, 2006, Mark Krasnoff shot himself on the banks of the Mississippi River. I went home to my grandmother.
No. Okay. Did we get him in? I don't know if they hear him.
What his character was. And
my best friend Sharon came to visit.
Who was Krasnoff?
We talked about Kraz and the pile of tapes left behind.
Part in the documentary.
Sharon offered to continue filming.
From the holes.
One of Kraz's last wishes was for our documentation work to be shared. I pieced together an art show I called Photo Coffin Boxes.
Mold treatment. When we came home to St. Bernard, this is what our walls looked like. This one's for my grandmother. And then the inside are photographs taken about a month and a half before he passed. A lover of life with a sensitive soul, he lived a full life, a good life, and though he expired unexpectedly, what he gave in life lives on, even in death, through the influence and inspiration that he exchanged with those he touched and the legacy of work he has left behind.
After BP's oil rig explodes off Louisiana's coast, I'm at a boat blessing to open shrimp season. No one's talking about the oil leak. I take my camera out shrimping with my cousin Charlie. This may be the last healthy catch of the season before the oil does its damage.
Yeah, and the big shrimp.
I go to talk with my cousin Clarice about the oil leak.
When you're gonna go out there, it's gonna be a nightmare. It's gonna be ugly, because it's gonna affect a lot more than just our marshes. And it could be killing our shrimp. It will kill our shrimp. And eventually, I imagine, you know, the marsh is gonna recuperate, but for how long? Because once it gets in our, because our marshes are like sponges. It's gonna get in there, and you can't go in there and mop it up. It's not going to work. Either you have to remove the marsh or let nature take its course. And how many years that's going to take?
We go to hear a BP representative speak to the community.
When this spill is cleaned up, we're not going away. We're still going to be drilling out here. We're still going to be employing people from Terrebonne and Lafourche Parish to work offshore. We're not going to stop drilling in the Gulf of Mexico after this event is over with. This is the best place to drill in the world, right here. So we're not going away.
All you gotta do is be my deck and look pretty on the front of the door.
Closed fisheries forced my family to work for the BP oil cleanup. The program is called the Vessels of Opportunity. Oil seeps into our wetlands. And this is growing to become the largest accidental oil spill ever in marine waters. I decided to finish my bachelor's degree at Loyola University in mass communication. I've started leading students and researchers on tours, giving a native perspective of Louisiana's environmental crisis.
During Hurricane Katrina, one of the holding tanks floated off of its base. Louisiana was full of, it was an enchanted forest. It was, you know, huge, massive cypress trees, amazing wetlands, ecosystem, estuaries, but it's just been cut down the trees, cut through the earth to make these waterways, to lay pipeline, to have shipping canals, to control.
I never wanted to become a political activist, but now I find myself bringing jars of oil from our bayous to the Senate.
Looks the same.
All I've ever wanted is to be home in Louisiana. On the same spot where my parents had their trailer, I'm building a portable home for myself out of a shipping container.
I would pull it in and start to think of a wall right here.
Since losing my father in Kras, I can see how the illness of our land and waters breeds illness on our people. But our love ties us to this place and makes us feel responsible to care for it. It was by instinct I first picked up a camera and started documenting my family. And now these images and stories bear witness to a disappearing Louisiana. I sometimes wonder, if I grow to be as old as my grandmother, will I be able to live by the cycles of the moon, collect rainwater in a cistern, and call my Louisiana home? Thank you.
ain't gonna stop.